in different lectures about Britain and Germany and Russia. So here I'm just going to do more of a general regional coverage for Western Europe. And today I just want to talk about that first part, which is probably the part that you've forgotten the most about, which is the Renaissance through the end of the Wars of Religion. So we're going to call this period the dawn of the modern age to differentiate it from the early modern age and then the modern age. That's all you're responsible for this year. You don't have to worry about anything past that. Okay, so we want to get started with the Italian and Northern Renaissance. And so kind of going back before this, we're coming out of the Middle Ages. By about 1200, Europe had developed those feudal institutions that we've gone over this year. And so what we're seeing by the time we get to 1450 is a high degree of urbanization in Italy as a result of the trade that had been reestablished between Italy and the Middle East during the Crusades. So these Italian cities like Florence, which becomes a banking center, and Venice, which is a shipping center, are going to lead the way here. So if we kind of look at this in terms of the big picture, what you need is a lot of money if you're going to have this investment in art. And so the money takes people further away from subsistence. So they don't have to worry so much about dying. You don't have to worry about some famine coming through and wiping out the village in these Italian cities. They're well enough off that they can focus on the here and now. And so there's this wealth that tends to impact the rest of it. So in Italian cities like Venice and Florence, Genoa, Rome, what we're seeing is the rise of a new merchant banker elite that was challenging the existing urban elite, which tended to be drawn from the nobility. And in some cities, what we end up with is just a blending of the two. You end up with a new group of nobles that just kind of intermarry with bankers and merchants. So the urban elite are going to patronize the arts as a way of trying to generate prestige. So they're trying to show that they are worthwhile citizens because they're the ones that paid for the statue that's in the middle of the square. All right, so then what we talked about way back at the beginning of the year is that this is primarily an urban event. It doesn't really impact people outside of the cities. And so the movements I'm about to talk about next are they would fall into that category. So we have humanism, and humanists, this is kind of a challenging philosophy to define. Sometimes people will start with, well, it's a textual criticism of the classics, right? Because we don't really know how to frame it early on. What it becomes is a philosophy revolving around the ability of human beings to use reason to understand the world. And that does come from that earlier textual criticism. So humanists were more likely to read a book by Cicero and then try to not just learn what Cicero had to say, but try to figure out if they agreed with him or disagreed with him. And so within humanism, then there's this challenge to existing knowledge and the status quo. You're telling people it's okay to challenge people using your ability to reason. So kind of the overarching development in humanism, then we start with this reading of Greek and Roman writings and simply understanding them better. A lot of this comes from their recovery of the Middle Ages. More of these books are found in monasteries. Some of it comes from people fleeing the declining Byzantine Empire. And so once people look at Cicero's writings and realize he's talking about government without referencing Christianity, then you start to move into this development of a way of thinking and a way to acquire knowledge that revolves around rationalism and reason. So one of the humanists, and I sent this out in my email, one of the names that you could use to illustrate this would be Mirandola. And Mirandola was an Italian humanist who was very optimistic, believed that humans had been given this ability to reason by God, and that they could use that ability to reason to understand the world. And so the gist of that is human beings and society both are perfectible using reason. All right? All right, moving on to these other isms. We've also got secularism and individualism. Now, to some degree, we can't really separate these from humanism. If you're a humanist and you're using reason to understand the world, then you are approaching the world from a secular perspective. But secularism more precisely means that you would consider certain parts of life without religious considerations. It doesn't mean you're anti-religious. It just means that you would say, okay, when I want to understand how the government works, what I should do is I should study the government. I shouldn't go read the Bible in order to figure out how human beings govern themselves. Well, that was new. In the Middle Ages, people did believe you should read the Bible, and then you should write about how a king should rule, not necessarily how the king actually did rule. So one of the secular political theorists that is important during this time is Machiavelli. He claims that it's by studying the existing governments of the time that he draws this conclusion that it's better to be feared than loved. It's better to, you know, inspire fear by randomly killing people from time to time than it is to try to rely too much on their respect. Individualism is a focus on your own potential. What are you trying to accomplish? Where do your talents take you? So it's not necessarily selfishness. The ideal that's emerging in Europe during this time is called enlightened self-interest. And this is what eventually Adam Smith will talk about, that your enlightened self-interest is going to guide the economy to the benefit of all people because you're going to pursue goods that are of the highest quality that you can afford. Individualism in this time period is going to strongly emphasize education. So you would try to be a Renaissance man. You would try to be good at a number of different things and not necessarily what we would call an expert today. And so these ideas then are going to be patronized by popes, patronized eventually by monarchs. And so the money being funneled into the arts is the reason we see these improvements in the arts. And so there are a couple of terms that are associated with Renaissance art that you need to know. And we've talked about them over this course. But just as a reminder, if we look at the bottom left, we've got the Last Supper. So you can see the geometric perspective employed in that painting. There's a vanishing point right behind Jesus. All the lines come directly to that point. It draws the viewer's attention directly to the center. And within that geometric perspective, we have other geometric shapes. Each group of the apostles is set in a group of three. That was by design. They're all on the other side of the table. And so the layout of these works of art, they're supposed to be rational and orderly. All right. The other really big development in the arts is naturalism, depicting the world as it actually appears. And so if you look at the bottom right, we have the two paintings of Christ carrying the cross. So Giotto was a late medieval painter. Some art historians would even consider Giotto to be early Renaissance because you can see some shading and color there, but it's not as realistic as what we would see with Titian. So Titian, his figure is carefully studied in order to replicate the human form. Right. That's not so of Giotto. In the Middle Ages, the whole point of depicting human beings was to tell some kind of story, usually a political or a religious narrative. Now, as the Renaissance moves to the north, there's an even greater emphasis on depicting humans naturally. And so there is more of a human-centered type of art. So we look up to in the top painting there, the Arnolfini marriage. Van Eyck is not worried about whether his human beings look great. He wants to depict them as they are. All right. Now, the spread of the Renaissance, and we'll see this again with the Reformation, is due to printing. And we've discussed this. Maybe the most important development in human history. And so the argument there goes that before this, information was so easily controlled and so difficult to come by that knowledge worked in a totally different way, right? Writing in order to convey the truth, it's just not something people did on a regular basis. You would write for effect. You would write to send a message. You would say that Noah was hundreds of years old as a way of conveying he was really old. You would say that when a city was sacked, 150,000 people were killed as a way of saying a lot of people were killed. And so this shift in the way reading works and writing works comes as a result of the printing press. And so the Renaissance ideas are going to spread rapidly as a result of printing moving from one urban center to another. But if you look at that map that shows the diffusion of Renaissance ideas, what we see is the movement of the Renaissance from urban center to urban center. In the Northern Renaissance, if you look at the Arnolfini marriage, it's a good depiction of this. What they relied on instead of geometric perspective was a careful study of the world to replicate perspective. And so when we say geometric perspective, we mean there's a sort of mathematical precision. That whole idea of establishing a vanishing point and drawing lines to it is geometric perspective. Van Eyck and other Northern Renaissance painters did not employ geometric perspective. They just studied a scene and tried to replicate it as it was and ended up pulling off the same effect. And I think that's where some of the confusion comes in. But no, in Northern Renaissance painters were not as associated with that geometric element of perspective. Still trying to show perspective though. The Renaissance has very little effect on the majority of Europeans. And so if we're kind of evaluating the relative significance of a movement like the Renaissance, you might downgrade it by saying in that time period, it really didn't affect many Europeans. Most Europeans were peasants and they would have lived their lives as they had before. And so if we kind of look at the traditional practices that are remaining in place, this describes one of them. Okay, then we've got on festive occasions, Dutch peasants engaged in goose pulls. This, by the way, is still done, right, in a ceremonial way. And so there's a rule in reading about laws. So when the city fathers decreed, no one, no matter who he is, will be allowed to ride, to stick, to pull, to hit, or otherwise cut open any swans, geese, roosters, rabbits, eels, herring, and other animals. What that tells us is all of these things happened. And the reason they made a rule is to stop it from happening. And so the entertainment of the day usually involved violence and animal bloodshed, if at the very least. And so a goose pull would involve you setting up this stand, and you would tie the goose by its legs, usually to the stand, and then you would ride up on horseback and try to grab the goose by its neck and essentially pull it apart, right? Kill it in that way. They do this today in the Netherlands with dead geese. Some areas have forbidden even the goose pulling of a dead goose. So but it's still going on. And there was this fixation on geese in Dutch art for a while as a result of this. But this would have correlated to things like bear baiting and dog fighting in other places. So that's what I mean. The Renaissance isn't really impacting the common European. They're still doing the things they always had done. They would still believe in spirits and magic. And so humanism and secularism and individualism had not impacted their lives. So the argument would go that the Renaissance is kind of a starting point and that it leads to all these other things. And so that's arguable. We'll see when we get there. All right, so new monarchy is the political change. So this is related to what we were discussing with Machiavelli. Machiavelli is studying governments as they actually work, and he is coming up with what we would call a secular political theory to defend the accumulation of power by the central government. And so new monarchy then is a centralizing system of government. All right, so what new monarchy is really just centralized feudalism. So it's going to involve monarchs trying to use the feudal institutions that are already there, but just draw more power to the capital. And so one example of this would be the militaries that they're trying to form. They were not yet to the point where most monarchs are going to form a state-run military, where the nobles aren't going to have their own private forces at all. That's yet to come. That's more strongly associated with absolutism, the new monarchy. But what we would see is monarchs trying to take control of more of the feudal estates. And so the King of England might, when a noble dies, cause that land to revert to the king. And so that means all of the knights that are on those estates now work for the king. And so there's not the same chain of command that you used to have in the feudal system, where a noble would levy knights, and that noble would give his knights to the noble above him, to the noble above him, and finally to the monarch, where the monarch is so dependent on feudal lords to either levy troops or not do so. So the idea here is that a more centralized monarch is better for the kingdom. A more centralized monarchy is better for the kingdom. And one reason that they could argue this is the beginning of the military revolution. And the military revolution would have happened throughout the world. But we see the Europeans, because European countries were always trying to wipe out other European countries, there's this competition between them. The Europeans are at the forefront of the military revolution as a result of that. And so the military revolution is first and foremost a shift to gunpowder weapons. And so the artillery, the other types of gunpowder weapons, the early muskets, the arquebus, and so on, these are expensive, they require more training. And so the European governments are going to struggle for a while to figure out this puzzle, right? How do you finance a modern gunpowder army? So eventually what they'll do is create a more centralized system of taxation. And new monarchs are going to move in that direction. But remember, at first, they don't have enough money for gunpowder armies. And so what they continue to rely on during this period are mercenaries, and they would levy armies and tell those troops, when you sack that city, you can rape the women, you can steal everything you can find, you can murder anybody who gets in your way. That's the early part of the military revolution. That's pretty destabilizing. And this is what the French and the English find out during the Hundred Years' War. When you just allow armies to go marauding through the countryside, stealing what they want to steal, it's hard to put that genie back in the bottle. And when you just tell the armies, enough is enough, we're done with sacking cities, well, that's how they're making their money, so they're not going to stop. So there's this search by monarchs for a way to generate enough revenue so they can have this modern and effective gunpowder force. So the flip side of this is, what if you don't develop a modern gunpowder force? Well, then you're destroyed. You're wiped off the map. Hungary ends up wiped off the map because they are not centralized enough to have these kinds of militaries. So another thing pushing European monarchs in the direction of centralization is the threat by a centralized Ottoman Empire. So the Sultan of the Ottoman Empire had already come up with a centralized gunpowder force, which is the Janissaries. Now, their solution to this puzzle was to draw slaves from conquered areas, train them how to fight in the army, and then release them from slavery. And it had, since these Janissaries owed everything to the Sultan, they tended to be extremely loyal. And so the Ottoman threat is going to push monarchies in places like Spain. So you can see on the map in the center how the Ottomans are creeping across the Mediterranean Sea, across North Africa. A lot of those cities in North Africa had been held by European monarchs until the Ottomans conquered them. And so that is another inspiration to try to centralize. So what we are getting to is there's a tension in this period between the rise of sovereign states in places like France and England and Spain versus this concept of universal Christendom, of all of the European countries being united together under a single Christian kingdom. Now, in the Middle Ages, this had already been shaken by the schism, where we end up with two and then three popes before they finally resolve it. And at this point, the Habsburgs are the main candidates for the creation of a universal Christian empire. And so that is going to provoke a backlash from your non-Habsburg states, especially France, which is caught in between the Habsburgs. So to give you one example of new monarchy outside of France and Britain, which we'll deal with separately, we have Ferdinand and Isabella. They are going to use Catholicism as a centralizing force. So in Spain, the monarchs had been such a help to the Catholic Church that popes had given Spanish monarchs a good deal of control over Catholic institutions within Spain. And one of those institutions was the Inquisition. So Ferdinand and Isabella could use the Inquisition as a tool not just to enforce Catholic orthodoxy, but to go after people who were enemies, nobles that were insubordinate. Ferdinand and Isabella, in addition to that, expelled the Jews and the Moors, the Muslims, from Spain as another centralizing tendency under the Catholic Church. So outside of the Catholic Church, Ferdinand and Isabella are a great illustration of monarchs that use feudal patterns in order to centralize. They took a feudal institution in Spain, which was these brotherhoods, kind of local organizations that had enforced the law, and they gave them additional power as a way of making those institutions a little bit more loyal to the monarchy. And so that it, we could see as centralizing as well. But still, Ferdinand and Isabella are monarchs over a newly unified, semi-feudal Spain. Aragon and Castile were two separate Spanish kingdoms. And what they did is they used this marriage as a way of unifying those two big Spanish kingdoms. So they're co-monarchs, essentially. If
They like formed like a union between Castile and Aragon.
right. And if you had elevated one above the other, then you would not have had the buy-in for that marriage and alliance that you did. Right? So in order to get both of those large, powerful Spanish states to agree to this, you had to agree that Ferdinand and Isabella were going to be monarchs alongside each other. So that means while they are the monarchs, you really don't have a Spain. There's no such thing as Spain. But as people get used to those two states being united, you end up with more national institutions over time. Okay, so then we'll move on to what is surely your third favorite part of history behind agricultural history and the history of art, which is the Protestant Reformation. So the Protestant Reformation is depicted over here on this chart. You have this division of Christianity. So we've already had one division between Catholics and Orthodox Christians. But at the point we're looking at, so 1450, 1500, Western Europe, the vast majority of Europe was under the Catholic Church. And so that's that hope of universal Christendom. And so what will happen here is the Catholic Church will split. You'll end up with Catholic churches still, but you will end up with a variety of groups that come out of a protest against the Catholic Church. So you can see the protest in there. They are trying to reform the church. And that's where this all gets started. So when we look at 1450, the church, there's a lot of corruption. The church had, over the late Middle Ages, centralized a good deal of religious control, and as a result, was in charge of a lot of money and a lot of land. And so if we're kind of trying to figure out, well, why is it in 1500 that the Protestant Reformation happens? So the corruption had been going on for a long time. But as a result of the printing press, people are much more aware of the corruption than before. And in addition to that, what we're going to talk about in this period following this is the boom in trade that's occurring in European countries. So we've already talked about the military revolution, and these things are intertwined. If you were a European monarch, you have a greater need for tax revenue than ever before. And so where European lords might have been willing to accept Catholic control of the best land in the Middle Ages when it didn't really matter as much, now they see this as a source of revenue potentially. And so what we're looking at as well is you have two groups of monarchs when we're looking at the Protestant Reformation. The Spanish, I already mentioned, their monarchs are are in this alliance with the Catholic Church. So for the Spanish, leaving the Catholic Church would involve a loss of power. This is true of the French as well. If the French monarchs had already developed an agreement with the Catholic Church, giving the French monarchs control over the appointment of bishops. If we're looking at monarchs, though, that have less to gain from an alliance with the Catholic Church, one example there would be the English, who feel like the Italians have too much control over money that they're drawing away from England and too much control over bishops being appointed in England. The northern princes of the Holy Roman Empire would have felt the same way. Austria had this alliance with the Catholic Church, so they have something to lose in leaving the Catholic Church. So that's kind of the environment leading into this period. So in addition to that, as the Renaissance had moved to the north, and away from Rome, the center of the Catholic Church, then you have a variety of humanists that are far more willing to turn the scrutiny of reason onto the teachings of the Catholic Church. And the most famous of these is Erasmus, who writes about the philosophy of Christ, where he is saying that the Catholic Church has basically lost its way and that it is no longer following the philosophy of Christ. Instead, Catholics are too worried about ritual, too worried about things that don't matter, like should a monk wear a horsehide robe, or is it okay if it's comfortable? How many times a day should you pray? And Erasmus says, none of those things matter. Stop arguing about those things and get back to the message of Jesus. And so that is kind of opening the door for this use of reason and a reread of the Bible to challenge the Catholic Church's monopoly over religious knowledge. That wasn't Erasmus's intent. He wrote a series of letters to Luther when the Reformation got started, arguing that the church remain unified. All right, now, so we've gone over some of the political and the economic causes. And so the other thing we're gonna go over is the intellectual cause, which is the printing press. And the printing press now makes it possible for a lot of different people to read the Bible. So when Gutenberg develops the first working movable type press, he prints the Bible. And so up until this time, Bibles were expensive. They were hard to come by. A family might have a single Bible. And so it's a natural outcome that when a lot of different people read the Bible, they're going to disagree over what the Bible says. And so you have the political centralization by monarchs and the resistance to that by nobles. You have the economic shift where tax revenue is going to be far more valuable. And so in areas where church revenue wasn't going to the monarch, there's a reason to break away. And then we have the awareness of different interpretations of the Bible. So earlier in the Middle Ages, there had been two dissenters from the church who had already said everybody should be able to read the Bible, the church shouldn't interpret Catholic doctrine. Everybody should be able to do that for themselves. Wycliffe in England and Jan Hus in Bohemia. And Hus had been burned at the stake. So this was a lesson to any reformers. And so the next of these reformers to come along is Martin Luther. So Martin Luther was based in northern Germany. And he was not a revolutionary at first. What he was bothered by was the church's sale of indulgences. The church was selling forgiveness for sins. And disproportionately, peasants were likely to buy indulgences because they had the most to gain. Life was terrible. You just wanted to ensure that you would get into the afterlife. So Luther is drawn out by one of the salesmen of indulgences using kind of modern business practices. He even comes up with a slogan, "When the coin and coffer rings, the soul from purgatory springs." So Martin Luther feels like indulgences, one, are a scam, you're ripping off the peasants, and two, have no power. They can't do anything, because Luther's reading of the Bible had led him to conclude that salvation was through faith alone, that God was all-knowing and all-powerful, therefore human beings could have no influence over God, so none of your actions can matter. Nothing that you do matters in terms of your salvation. Only your faith matters. And so Luther had believed that before, but now he's going to be drawn out. So he post the 95 Theses, according to legend, he nails it to the church door in Wittenberg as a way of throwing down the gauntlet to the church. The church responds. They send an official up to debate Luther. Over the course of that debate, Luther goes beyond the 95 Theses, which had basically just called for an end to the sale of indulgences. And Luther then claims that priests and the Pope have no special connection to God. Therefore, you have this kind of priesthood of all believers, where everyone can read the Bible for themselves and interpret it. And so that is something he is able to do because he had support from one of the northern German princes, the Elector of Saxony. And so the Elector of Saxony, one of these northern German princes who's a lot to gain in this situation, kind of vacillates. Does he believe Luther? Does he not? And he just keeps sending the Pope these messages like, we're going to wait and see. We're going to wait and see. No, I'm not going to send them to you. We're going to wait and see. And so finally, the Emperor of the Holy Roman Empire, Charles V, calls a council. At that council, Luther refuses to recant again. And here I stand. He's basically saying, I'm standing on doctrine. What is your defense? And so that is what's going to kind of get the ball rolling. Well, Martin Luther, though, is more of a conservative reformer, and he did not want this to be some revolutionary movement. When he begins to attract converts, he emphasizes the power that political leaders should have over religious institutions still, even though he's arguing that the Pope doesn't have any power. He wants to create some kind of hierarchy similar to what the Pope has. All right? So that's the start of it all. But really, at this point, we're talking about Reformation in northern Germany. So the radicalization comes in a variety of ways. So when we say radical, what we mean is that there are going to be Protestant reformers who are going to take some of Luther's core ideas, and they're going to attack the status quo with those ideas. So one of those groups would be the peasants, who think that Martin Luther, in saying that everybody is equal before God, is basically leading in the direction of abolishing serfdom, right? That's the natural outcome. If serfdom was supported by the Catholic Church because supposedly this hierarchy was ordained by God, then you should get rid of it all. That's a radicalization. Martin Luther condemns that. Another group that radicalizes is the Anabaptists. The Anabaptists thought that religion was purely a matter of conscience. You should have no connection between the state and the religion. Everyone should be free to either join a religion or not join a religion when they reach adulthood. And they believed as well that property should be held in common. And then last, we have John Calvin, who is a radical in the sense that he believes that there should be something more like a theocracy in terms of the government, and not that you should have what Luther wants, which is the prince controlling religious institutions. And it should be the other way around. The religious institution should be the ultimate authority. And Calvin is radicalizing Christianity as well by emphasizing even more strongly than Luther the all-knowing, all-powerful nature of God. So that is going to lead to more extreme versions of Protestantism. And so one of the things that we should see here is that this intensity of religious feeling and this disagreement over religious belief is going to put a lot of pressure on political leaders to demonstrate their piety, demonstrate their faithfulness. And so one of the outcomes of that is witch hunts. So the witch hunts are a product of all kinds of forces converging in one place. You have the economic changes that we've talked about, which is leading to social changes. And so the normal human reaction occurs, which is blame the outsider, blame the group that does not fit in. And so the targets above all of witch hunts were single adult women, right? So the women who had not married, which is the norm, right? You're supposed to get married. That was the choice. You either get married or you join the church. And so they had not gotten married. They tended to live on kind of the outskirts of society otherwise. A lot of times the witch hunts would target women who had cats as pets because it was suspect to have that kind of relationship with an animal was the thinking during that time. The suspicion of wild animals is not something that goes away in European life until really the late 19th century. And you'll still see works of art in literature in the late 19th century where they're terrified that bears are going to come out of the forest and get you. And so this is going to lead to thousands of mostly women being burned as witches. As at this point, magic is thought to be satanic. And so it kind of goes right into the intensity of religious feeling during this time. So Luther believed that you should still have a church hierarchy, that you wanted bishops. Because Luther, again, is conservative. He is, at some level, terrified by the idea that everybody would kind of take him at his word and interpret scripture on their own. That would lead to chaos and disorder, he thinks. So he is on that more conservative side. Now, the Presbyterians are an offshoot of Calvin, the Calvinists. And the Calvinists never come to any consensus on this, but what they are basically getting to is this idea that religious communities themselves should determine doctrine. And so there are a variety of forms of this. The Presbyterian group is one form that you would have groups that would elect the presbyter, who would be the person, an educated person who would figure out doctrine. Or you have Congregationalists, where the congregation as a whole would do things like choose a pastor. And so that's where you get a lot of the differences is should you have a hierarchy or should you not have a hierarchy? And a lot of this will come back down to a reading of the Bible. When Catholics and Lutherans read the Bible, they emphasize the passage that talks about Jesus choosing Peter to start his church. When the Calvinists read the Bible, they read that as being symbolic only, and that there is no church hierarchy in Jesus' time, so there shouldn't be a church hierarchy now. And so that a lot of it is little differences between doctrine. Okay, so this brings us to the Catholic Reformation. We can ballpark this as being right around 1550. And so at this point, you have the religious diversity we see on the map. And that sparks a backlash. The Catholic Church feels like it's slipping away. They need to reassert their power. And so sometimes this is referred to as the Counter-Reformation because Protestants are accusing the Catholics of just trying to repress the Protestant Reformation. The Catholics are emphasizing the Reform movement aspect of this. So the kind of at the core of it is the Council of Trent. The Council of Trent is going to finally fix some of the problems in the Catholic Church, like the corruption that to some degree starts the Reformation. So the Council of Trent is going to say the Catholic Church can issue indulgences, but selling them is corrupt. The Catholic Church can appoint bishops, but selling the position of bishop is corrupt. And so a lot of these things had been rules in the Catholic Church already. If the Catholic Church had simply called a council 50 years earlier, they might have headed off the Reformation, or at least kind of limited the scope of the Reformation, but they don't. Otherwise, though, what the Council of Trent does is announces that the Protestants are all wrong, that the Catholic Church is right on every point of doctrine that the Protestants disagree with. And so the Protestants are going to say salvation is through faith alone, or in the case of Calvin, you are predestined by God to either be saved or not. And the Catholics are going to say, no. Salvation is through faith and your good actions, your good works. The Council of Trent is going to reassert the power of the Pope to interpret doctrine. And so you have the creed that comes out of the Council of Trent, the Tridentine Creed, as kind of the re-articulation of church doctrine. So this gives us a good idea of where the Catholic Reformation is going. On the one hand, the Catholic Reformation is about reforming the church and cleaning up the problems in the church. But on the other, it's about getting back what the Catholic Church had lost and keeping people within the Catholic Church. and repressing Protestantism. And so we see these with a couple of different of the elements of the Catholic Reformation. So the Jesuits, this is a Christian organization, a Catholic organization formed during the Catholic Reformation. And the Jesuits are known as missionaries. They're known as educators. They establish really good schools. And so the mission of the Jesuits then is to spread Catholic doctrine both around the world and within Europe. And so the choice that they're making is to spread that doctrine by really knowing Christian doctrine well, by connecting Christian doctrine with the latest education of the time, and by convincing people that they should want to be Catholic, right? You want to draw them back in. At this point, it looks like the Protestant Reformation has all of the energy. And then there's the compulsory arm of this, which is the Roman Inquisition. So the Spanish had already used the Inquisition to hunt down and oftentimes execute people who disagreed with their doctrine. And now we see this spread to Italy. And so what happens is that in areas that use the Inquisition to repress Protestantism, Protestantism does not spread. So it's pretty effective in areas that were already staunchly Catholic. So there's no threat of Protestantism making inroads in Spain. All right, what we also see is a shift in the arts. So again, this is a very emotional time because of the religious disagreements. And so we see art break away from that cold rationalism of the Renaissance and move in a direction that is more emotional and dramatic. And so in the top right-hand corner, we have the El Greco painting of Toledo. So the light breaking over Toledo. Often in Mannerist and Baroque arts, light symbolized the divine. And so you can see there's no geometric perspective. It's not especially naturalistic. There is a lot of distortion of the landscape. This is even more true of Baroque art. Now, Baroque art starts during the Catholic Reformation and was basically the visual art element of the Catholic Church trying to retain people. But Baroque art is going to catch on as well as a way for absolute monarchs to build support. So I have the two statues of David. On the left, we have Michelangelo's Renaissance David, who is calm and impassive. He's stoic. And then we have Bernini's David in the Baroque style, in the act of slinging the stone, in movement. And so you have the intense look on his face. So those are elements of Baroque versus Renaissance art. And so during the Catholic Reformation, you have Baroque sculptors like Bernini and Caravaggio with the calling of St. Peter, or of St. Matthew, trying to revitalize this spirit of the Catholic Church and trying to use this kind of thing to awe people in the Catholic Church's power. All right, so the last thing I want to go over are the wars of religion. And so the ideas between the different churches we've already described as kind of being, by our standards, trivial, right? So people were disagreeing over things like what happened when you went through the ceremony of communion. So the whole idea of the bread being the body of Christ and the wine being the blood. What actually happened there? Well, the Catholics said that what happened is during that ceremony, you transformed the wine and bread into the body and blood of Christ. And then the Lutherans said, no. The Holy Spirit was present, but there was no transformation. And then the Calvinists said that, no, it's purely symbolic. No transformation occurred at all. And over those different views religiously, people were willing to kill each other. And it's kind of like if you were driving down the street and you saw a Lutheran church and you're like, oh, they're heretics. They deserve to die. That was the mindset during this time. Religious pluralism led to greater religious intolerance in the short term. And so where Protestantism seemed to spread, remember, there is also a political and economic price. The Catholic Church is losing land. If you are the Habsburg Emperor and princes are converting to Lutheranism, they are to some degree or another withdrawing loyalty by not participating in your state religion, the Catholic Church. And so this will set off a series of religious wars. So when we get to we get to France and we get to England, we'll talk about specifically what occurs as far as religious wars and Reformation there. But broadly speaking, in Europe, looking at the areas outside of Germany and outside of Spain or outside of France and England, we have a revolt in the Netherlands. So the Dutch rebel against Habsburg rule. So they were ruled by Philip II of Spain. He controlled that territory. So you can see in the map on the bottom left, the Habsburg territories in Europe, and then you can see the Habsburg territories overseas right beside it. That's why there was this fear of a universal Habsburg Empire. So the Dutch Revolt happens for religious and political and economic reasons. So the religious part, many people in the Netherlands had converted to Calvinism. They were drawn to Calvin's message that all work was valued by God, and that accumulation of wealth was not sinful. And many of the people in the Netherlands were merchants and bankers, so this was an appealing message. And then you have the political economic element. What Philip II attempts to do is to tax the Netherlands directly. This was in violation of the traditional feudal rights that the elite of the Netherlands had. And so when the Dutch refused to go along with Philip II's Catholicism on the one hand and political economic policies on the other, he threatens to send in the Inquisition. That sparks an uprising, and people go around and do things like destroy altars and churches. So Philip II is even angrier, and he sends in the Duke of Alva, who is going to create a council called the Council of Troubles, which the Dutch nicknamed the Council of Blood. So again, you go from a situation where Philip II could have solved these problems to an even greater uprising. And so the Dutch Revolt expands, it brings in the English. This is the conflict that the Spanish Armada is destroyed in. And so the Dutch Revolt ultimately will end with the northern part of the Netherlands breaking away from the southern part, declaring independence, declaring itself to be the Dutch Republic, and becoming a Calvinist state. The biggest war was the Thirty Years' War, and we'll talk about this in more detail with when we get to the Germany lecture. But you have in the top right-hand corner the Holy Roman Empire. And so the Holy Roman Empire is governed by the Habsburgs in a way, right? They're the emperors, but they're elected. And so the emperors of the Holy Roman Empire had historically been more like an umpire in baseball, right? They call balls and strikes, but they don't participate in the game itself. And so what had happened as time has gone on is that the Habsburgs had been put in a position where they were seen as defenders of the Catholic Church. And so as time has gone on, they had acted more as defenders of the Catholic Church. So you can't be that impartial umpire if you're on one side or the other. And so that is going to set off an uprising, starting in Bohemia. And so in Bohemia, the Habsburgs will try to reinstitute Catholicism, and they will famously take the two officials and try to throw them out the window, the defenestration of Prague. And that sets off the 30 Years' War. And the 30 Years' War becomes a general European war. So the first phase ends, the Catholics are about to begin. So that leads to intervention from the King of Denmark. He loses. The Catholics look like they're going to win to an even greater degree than before. That leads to Gustavus Adolphus, the King of Sweden, intervening. And eventually he dies on the battlefield. So the French get involved. And when the French get involved, this completely transforms the war. Because the French were Catholic. And at this point, the prime minister was a guy, Richelieu, who was a Catholic cardinal. And yet they side with the Protestants. And so the 30 Years' War is portrayed by many historians as ending this era of religious conflict and kind of introducing this period where we're going to have sovereign states. They're going to make treaties like the Peace of Westphalia. They're going to be concerned more for political matters than than over religious concerns. And so the French are trying to prevent they're trying to prevent the Habsburgs from being strong in Germany and in Spain. That's what's motivating them rather than religious concerns. All right. So that is the end of part one.